It's an old saying that prevention is better than cure. And this slide shows us a good example of that. Wouldn't you rather listen to a fire alarm than being stuck putting out a raging fire? But this picture is about more than just that. This is a reminder to us that prior knowledge is power, and it can even be life-saving. And that is no more true than in our healthcare system, where costs are skyrocketing, the system is overtaxed, and curing disease is often more like putting out a fire than really knowing what's going on. Now, there are at least two ways for us out of this gloomy paradigm. One of them is we can develop early healthcare warnings, like a fire alarm for our healthcare. And the second is we can better understand the basic mechanisms of human disease. Now, fortunately, there is at least one tool in our medical care toolkit that can help us in this endeavor through better prevention and better understanding of the nature of disease. And this, of course, is DNA. In fact, if everyone was able to get their genome sequenced and was willing to share their health data with researchers, we could make discoveries that would prevent and possibly cure all of the diseases that cause our suffering. Now, not only that, we could potentially empower our physician colleagues to become less firefighters and more the kind of individuals who manage and avert disease risk while speeding to new disease cures. Now, understanding DNA is essential to this vision. DNA is that 3 billion long string of letters that you inherit from your mother and from your father. It's a molecule that occupies virtually every cell in your body, and it's the molecule that can miraculously copy itself. And if it did that job perfectly, we would not have a story here to tell. But every now and again, about 100 times in each new person, there's an error in the copying and a wrong letter gets inserted. We call that a mutation. And if the mutation occurs in a critical gene, you can have a genetic disease. So, wouldn't it be perfect if you could take your whole genome sequence on a computer disk into your doctor's office and have her read it and tell you about any future health concerns that you might have or not? This would be like you having a fire alarm for your healthcare. Now, this was one of the parts of the vision for the Human Genome Project and the technologies we've developed since, beginning almost 40 years ago. Now, together with our talented group here in Houston at Baylor College of Medicine, and with thousands of collaborators around the world, we sequenced the first human genome. We began that project in 1990 and completed it in 2003. Since then, we've gone on to develop the field of personalized genomics, where we can actually look at complete individual DNA sequences and study individuals' healthcare trajectory. So how does this mean we are doing in our general quest? Well, let me tell you one story. And now this is one story of many, but it is one of the very first stories of its kind. And this beautiful child is my grandniece, Molly. So she's my sister's granddaughter, my niece's child. Molly was born after her mother's fairly uneventful pregnancy, and Molly's first few months of life were also just fine. But at a certain time, she began to develop symptoms her parents saw of weakness in her upper body and other developmental anomalies. Now, Molly visited many doctors and had many tests, but none of them could explain the source of her problems. Molly had no relevant family history and no apparent environmental encounters that really explained her malady. That there was just no explanation. So when my sister and Molly's mother called me about 10 years ago, it was a case of the universe offering us perfect timing. We had just developed new methods that made DNA sequencing faster, cheaper, but still accurate enough for us to sequence entire families. So what if we sequence Molly and her parents and look to see if there might be a mutation that caused her disease? Well, as you can probably guess, that's exactly what we did. It was kind of a risky experiment, and it took several months, but we sequenced Molly, her parents, and we found a mutation in a gene for which we did not know very much about at the time. We very quickly found three other families that had a similar story, and together we had defined a new syndrome. Now, Molly, then, is one of the around 1% of us that has an important mutation that can affect her lifelong healthcare trajectory. Now, most people with such mutations are not as severely affected, that they end up as a child with a severe anomaly in a doctor's office. But a very small fraction of 1% is still a very large number of people. And so Molly and her family and the 300 or so other families we know with the same syndrome now join the thousands upon thousands of other individuals who have children with rare genetic diseases for whom we know the root cause of their problems, thanks to DNA sequencing, and who are now seeking cures for those diseases, working with researchers like us. So this is the story in the children. So how are we doing in adults? Why don't we just go out there and sequence adults? Well, we could, technically, but it'd be very expensive. It still costs more than around $1,000 to sequence a human genome. And so to sequence everybody in aggregate would just be too expensive. There's another reason, though, that we don't just rush out and sequence random adults. Unlike the situation in Molly and her colleagues and friends, adult genetic diseases are more complicated. Adult diseases tend to have contributions from environmental factors, stochastic or chance factors, and then there are often very many genes involved in each complex adult disorder. In fact, we now know that if we really want to solve these adult genetic puzzles, we need the genome sequences of literally millions of people. Not only that, but we need very detailed health information on each one of them. And so, in turn, we have come to realize that the best way to get this information is in the doctor's office. After all, your doctor is used to taking detailed health notes about you and is even used to preventative medicine, for example, testing your cholesterol to see if you have heart disease or are likely to develop heart disease. So our dream is to fully integrate these genomic sequencing efforts into every clinical encounter in a way that can allow the individuals to share their health data with researchers in a fashion that's protected, their privacy is protected, to allow those researchers to develop these preventative disease fire alarm models, as well as to advance our understanding of human genetic disease. So this dream sounds pretty straightforward, but there's a catch. The catch is that right now, genomic sequencing is simply not useful enough in the clinic for it to be very widely accepted. And conversely, because genomic sequencing is not very widely accepted in the clinic, we don't have the data from it to make it universally useful. We call this the catch-22 of genomic sequencing and clinical genomic translation. Now, if only we could sequence all these people and share their data, we could revolutionize part of the healthcare problem. So let me give you one brief vignette, a thought experiment that illustrates the power of this vision, and it's one that's very relevant to today. From the beginning of the COVID pandemic, it was clear that some individuals developed more severe disease than others, but we did not know why. Imagine if we'd already had the genomic sequence of millions of individuals in their healthcare records, we were able to access those healthcare records, and we could also know the COVID status and the disease outcome for those individuals. We could have used a computer to do the experiment very quickly to ascertain what were the innate factors that gave rise to severe COVID disease. Now, those studies are ongoing, and some have even been completed, but the point is they have been retrospective, and they were very cumbersome to organize. And we want more for our human genetic disease studies. So how can we get out of this catch? Well, one thought is that we can look to individuals who already seek genetic testing. People planning families who may have some knowledge of a distant relative who has a genetic disease are likely to seek genomic sequencing in order to plan their own child, their own reproductive future. Altruists participate in scientific studies where they may have their genome sequenced. And we know of at least a couple of large studies around the world right now that aim to accrue the data for more than 1 million people's sequences each. And these are already contributing to our health knowledge. But our problem is that not everybody is pregnant, nor everybody wants to be an altruist. In fact, not everybody can be an altruist because it can simply be too difficult for them to do that logistically. So we thought long and hard about this problem. How can we break out catch-22? How can we get genomic sequencing into people's lives in a way that both gives them something in return, incentivizes them to participate in research, and doesn't disrupt their everyday lives? Now, an important aspect of genetics helps us here. I said a moment ago that many adult conditions have many genes that contribute to them. But there are adult conditions which are driven by single gene effects, just like in Molly. But the situation is that those mutations in those individuals were never detected in childhood. They persisted through to adulthood, and now they're affecting adult health. So maybe we could design a study where we could look for those kind of mutations, and if we were successful, then we would have a reason to do more genomic sequencing in the clinic, we'd have a toehold, and we could begin to drive towards this vision of having ubiquitous genomic sequencing in health. Now, we thought hard about which conditions to study. We actually spent a lot of time thinking about cancer and the complexities of DNA sequencing and DNA analysis there. But in the end, we settled on cardiovascular disease risk. After all, cardiovascular disease is the number one killer. About 1 in 4 people die of that in the US. Not only that, but genetic studies in adult cardiovascular health are actually quite advanced relative to some other disease disciplines. So we decided to study that condition. Now, it didn't make any sense to run out and try and sequence everybody to determine their cardiovascular disease risk genes. Nor did it make any sense to sequence people who were already in advanced disease, perhaps in the hospital already. Their fire alarm essentially had already gone off. So we designed a study to target intermediate categories of individuals. And with our physician colleagues, we organized to enroll in a study people from all walks of life, bus drivers and bank tellers, and people who, for some reason, were seeking out some kind of cardiological health care. They could be people with a mild heart attack, but also people with just very mild chest symptoms. Over the course of a year, we studied 700 people. We were actually trying to study 1,000, but COVID got in the way, so we stopped the study then. Our physician colleagues consented and drew blood from these individuals, and we got their DNA sequence, and then we returned a genetic report to each one of them. At the end of the study, we had made an amazing discovery. A little more than 30% of the individuals had genetic data returned to them that affected their future health care. This number of 30% is actually an astounding number. But even more surprising to us was that within the 700 participants, nearly 10% of them had a strong mutation of the class that we saw in Molly. That is, they were one of the 1% or so of us with a mutation that is guiding their health trajectory through their whole lives. Some of these people had familial lipid disorders, others malformations, and some others connective tissue disorders, but they were all in this class of being the 1%. So our proof of concept had worked. We now have the reason to recommend more of these tests in cardiovascular clinics. We have the incentive for these individuals to participate in this kind of research, and we now have the motivation to move these tests over into other disease systems as we march systematically towards this grand vision of having genome sequencing in every clinical encounter. So we have our fire alarm. We have now the information we need to begin to develop these early warning prevention systems. And even more importantly, we now are in a situation where we can assist our physician colleagues in their endeavor to become less like firefighters and more like those who manage and avert disease risk. So our clinical translation study has worked. We have broken the catch-22. Now, what does this mean for everyone? What does this mean for you? Well, what it means is now, if you go into the clinic to see your doctor for any condition that may really remotely be influenced by a genetic factor, you really can legitimately justify you asking that question. Should I have my genome sequenced? Thank you.